Now, back to the left-hand two sliders underneath each oscillator, the ones that are marked FM frequency modulation. Now, the left-hand one, this is pink-topped, because with the switch in the upper position, it's LFO control. In fact, actually, in both positions, it's LFO control when you're looking at VCO1. So let's raise the slider to increase the depth of effect that the LFO has on the pitch of VCO1. And we can change the LFO frequency. So that allows everything from sort of subtle vibrato up to really not so subtle pitch changes. On the pre-PPC Odysseys, the only way of adding vibrato was to move up this FM slider. Which is fine if you're just using one oscillator. But of course, if you're using both oscillators, then you need to move up both sliders, or you're only getting vibrato on one of the two oscillators, which could sound a little bit weird. Sort of like this. Because then you've got one oscillator beating against the other one because the pitch of one's changing and the other isn't. And I suppose you could try doing both sliders at once, but I can't imagine it's easy. Yeah, that's not easy at all. Probably easier when they were new and the sliders moved a bit more freely. Not that they are particularly stiff on this, but yeah, it's not easy. There's a bit of a distance between them. You've got to be very careful. You move the right two sliders and sort of pushing them up and pulling them back. Yeah, not ideal. I guess this never occurred to me before for the simple reason that I own an Odyssey that has PPC fitted. But of course, on the older units, you could always do vibrato using the old-fashioned, non-lazy, manual way of doing it. After all, the pitch bend knob affects the pitch of both oscillators together, so you have a single control, which, by waggling it, you can generate vibrato. Now, I know there are a lot of synth players who prefer that method, saying that it gives a more natural vibrato, because, of course, you've got control over not only the depth of the vibrato, but over the speed of it as well. I've never played an older Odyssey with the pitch bend, so I don't know how easy it would be to do that. I don't know how big of a dead spot there is in the middle. And of course, there's the fact that I don't think it's sprung loaded, so you've got to be very careful to leave it at the correct pitch when you've finished doing vibrato. But at least there is that single control available on the older Odysseys that you could do vibrato without resorting to having to push up both sliders. So this is where the PPC comes in. And the middle pad here, with a little sine wave over it, that's vibrato. Now, these pads are pressure sensitive, and the more you press them, the greater the depth of the effect. I've seen a lot of videos of people sort of pressing them down here, or, you know, they sort of stab them with the finger end, and I don't know. That, to me, doesn't seem the best way of using them. I think, really, what works best, certainly for me, is if you lay your finger across it like that and then just sort of roll it forwards. Unfortunately, I can't really demonstrate the use of this terribly well because my Odyssey isn't currently on a firm surface, and instead of pressing the pad harder and getting more vibrato, the more I press the pad, the more the synth moves, and it doesn't really change the vibrato because the synth's moving, not the pad. So, yeah. But take it from me that it does normally sort of work quite nicely. Whilst we're at it, why not let's look at the pitch changes. And again, the harder you press it, the more the pitch bends up or down, depending which pad you press. Now, again, they work quite nicely. They feel quite nice to use, but you don't get the fine control that you get with a pitch wheel. And certainly with mine, the pitch bend up, I think I can get a fourth or a fifth. Fourth. And I think about the most I can get on the pitch bend down is a minor third. Ish. And there's no way of changing that. Whereas on most synths, you can change the pitch bend range, and you know that if you've got it set on an octave and you slam it as far as it'll go one way or as far as it'll go the other, you'll get exactly an octave up or an octave down, or you can set it for a tone. So, you know, you just slam it to the end stop and it will be in tune. And you can't really do that with the PPC. I think the more you use it, the more practice you have with it, the better it is to use and the more control you have. You only need to change the pressure very slightly and you're out of tune. You certainly can't do octave bends with it, not on mine anyway. And you can't really change the pitch and do vibrato at the same time. So I always find you bend the note and you get it in tune, and then the moment you start trying to add vibrato, the pressure that you're applying to the pitch pad changes. And it just really doesn't work. And frankly, that is for me one of the biggest drawbacks with the Odyssey. But there are ways and means of getting around that, but that's a different story. So where were we? Ah, yes, LFO control of the oscillator frequency. So with the switch in the upper position, you've got sine wave LFO control of the pitch. With it in the lower position on VCO1, you've got square wave modulation of the frequency of oscillator 1. So what that gives you is a more trill-like effect. And you can get quite obnoxious sounds out of that. Now, this is one of the differences between VCO1 and VCO2, that same slider on VCO2, switch in the upper position does the same thing, sine wave LFO control of the pitch, but in the lower position, instead of square wave trill-like effect, it's controlled by the sample and hold mixer or pedal. Now, I believe the pedal, if you plug in an expression pedal, you can then sweep the pitch of oscillator 2 with the pedal. I've never tried this. I think this is probably designed most for sync sounds, and that's something I'll get onto in a little bit. So the second FM slider is the same function for both oscillators. With a switch in the upper position, this gives sample and hold modulation of the frequency of the oscillator. And that sounds like this. So that gives you the classic sample and hold, chaotic, random, stair-stepping sound. And I'll get into the fine detail of the sample and hold section a bit later. Now, the switch under this slider, if you put it into the lower position, that gives you envelope control of the pitch of the oscillator. So what that does is, as you move the slider up, it changes the pitch. But it changes the pitch over time in a way that is governed by the shape of the envelope that you create with the envelope generator. So at the moment, we've got a tiny little bit of attack on there, which I hadn't realised we had. The sustain level's at maximum, so it should hold a constant pitch when you hold a note down. And there's a bit of release on, so when you let go of the note, the pitch drops back down. And you can just hear that little bit of scoop up at the beginning of the note. And it tailing off. But of course, you can get really creative with this. Let's move the very stiff attack slider. Pull the sustain right down. And you get a very sharp transition there between the attack phase and the sustain level. But you can smooth this out by moving the decay up. I said earlier about my envelopes sagging a bit. And what I mean by this is that the sustain level isn't level, unfortunately. It should be. And there's an easy way of demonstrating this. Let's put the sustain level back up, bring the attack down, bring in oscillator 2. Now, of course, because we're applying a change to the pitch, VCO1 is no longer in tune with VCO2, so we'll retune it. Now, those should be more or less in tune. And because I tuned them when I'd been holding the note down for a while, when you've been holding the note down for a while, they're in tune. But you can hear what I mean about it sagging, because once it gets up to the sustain level, actually VCO1's a little bit sharp, and then it gradually drifts downwards until the two are in tune. And then it's starting to go flat. And that's a bit of a shame, because you can do nice effects like this, but you can't really tune it properly because the envelope's not functioning perfectly. There was a nice patch I did on my axe where there was quite a lot of envelope control of the pitch of the oscillator, and the pitch would glide up and it would hold a constant pitch. And then it sort of dropped down nicely as you release the note. But it doesn't work so well on this because it isn't functioning properly. It's another thing that needs addressing when I get it serviced. But again, you can go from subtle effects to not so subtle effects. That's really not terribly subtle. Especially if you do things like, let's bring the sustain level down again and a bit of attack so it scoops up. Oh, bloody hell. Oh. Maybe not terribly musical, but it's an interesting effect. But I mean, you can do stuff like put the sustain level back up again. Falling foul of the envelope sagging a bit and not being perfectly in tune.